She has been a Miss India. She has been an actor. She has been a national swimming champion. She has been an activist. She has been an army wife. She has been a political aspirant. And she is now a cancer survivor and warrior. But for all these tags and titles that one can give Nafisa Ali, she is first and foremost very much her own person. She has demonstrated that it is possible to make unconventional choices and then buck those unconventional choices all over again. First, to enter films when there was no room for somebody from her family who had, they had never entered films before. And then, having had an absolutely dream debut with a film like Junoon, seminal in Indian cinematic history, she then chose to give it all up. That demonstrates the art of being oneself and the conviction in oneself that somebody her age then, 21, should almost not have had. But she has demonstrated that through the course of a very, very richly lived life. And it is an absolute privilege to start that conversation with her. Where does she find the courage to be her own person? May we have up on stage Nafisa Ali. Nafisa, instead of me trying to explain who you are, because actually I can't answer that question either, let me ask you a rather direct question. Who are you?
Well, right now, I was lying by the pool, and I was just thanking God for giving me a year of my life, because the last year has been the most difficult in my life. And I think it's the courage of believing in hope, in following my dreams. And even if my dream comes crashing down, believe my dream again can rise and I can have another beautiful dream. So I think that's who I am, the little girl who keeps dreaming.
Were you, is that how you remember yourself from your earliest age? Will you tell us a little about your growing years? You grew up in Kolkata.
Yes, I was born, brought up in Calcutta. My ancestors belonged to a little village outside Calcutta called Tajpur, which is near Shirampur. And it was always special because my father used to always take us back on the weekends to our village home and the village pond and all my village relatives. And we used to play in the fields and go and steal the neighbor's chana, you know, the green chana. And used to eat all that. So, and then we used to run around all over, swimming, climbing trees, eating mangoes. You know, the childhood that is, in my opinion, perfect. You know, without boundaries, be careful, don't do this, don't do that. I just ran riot.
Is that where, did the village pond produce a national swimming champion?
Yeah, I think so. It because I just loved water, and my father was very... You know, if my father had not taken the... Of course, I was a school swimming champion and all those things. But if my father had not got me up every morning at 5 o'clock, taken me for training, brought me home, given me breakfast, dropped me to school, picked me up from school, brought me home so I could sleep for an hour and then go back to training. You know, my growing years were just training. I was not only when the swimming was over, when... it was winter, then I would be in training for sport because I was also an inter-school athletic champion. So I was just so consumed with the passion of, I was just consumed by passion. So I didn't have time for TV or many friends or phone calls. So my friends who are in my life were there then and they're there even today. So.
You
that
know,
special bond.
One of the, and I may be jumping ahead, but the way you speak of swimming as a passion, I think one of the intriguing things is that mostly you see passion in this kind of intense, serious-minded way. You obviously put everything you had into this because you cannot become national swimming champion without it. But you wear your passion lightly while giving it all the rigor. Where do you get this lightness from?
Well, it's the independence of knowing that it's only you out there. And you know, swimming is a very lonely sport because you've just got your head either looking at the sky or looking into the water. And lack of oxygen and training. So it makes you a philosopher. You know, it makes you think. I mean, what do you do? You have an intelligent mind. What do you do? So you have to become a thinker. And I think swimming has given me that capability to analyze and to circumvent, to sort of go back into thought and try to do what is good or best or stand up for what is wrong to help people. I think that's what sportsman spirit has given me.
And
to you try your best. Of course, I won everything. That's different. But you don't need to win. You have to have the sportsman spirit.
Were you competitive by nature always? And was that limited to sport?
I was competitive because I always... But you know, my best friend, when I was in swimming, I was the best. But in sport, my best friend was always the winner. And she left school at the age of 7 and went to another school. In class 7, and she went to another school. After which, I became the champion. So it's not... So my best friend, we were never in competition with each other because she always came first and I always came second. And after she left, I always won. So I think... A bond is very important.
That means
you don't, you must do your best. You know, don't sort of lose out because you think she's better than me. Do your best.
You've said that you were a tomboy, and in your description right now you said jumping into the village pond and climbing trees and so on. How does a tomboy go on to become Miss India?
But in all truth, I would be honest, because my father was a photographer, a legendary photographer from Calcutta, and my parents were always doing all sorts of modeling assignments over and above every other work he did, and I was always either before the camera from a tiny age, modeling for some back. For radio, paints, this, that. So it just was, I just sort of kind of liked the glamour world. And then I saw one day in the news, in the Eves Weekly. Our days we had Feminine Eves Weekly. Do you remember? My mom used to subscribe to Eves Weekly. So I saw the ad for Miss India and all that. There was a television. And TV was just coming to Calcutta. I mean, to India. And I told my parents, just don't worry, I'm going to win this for you. You know, I took it like another competition. And
so you're saying you entered Miss India not to win Miss India, but to win a television?
Absolutely. Because I was a tom, I never thought. In fact, after I won Miss India and I remained exactly like I was, torn clothes, dirty t-shirt, however I was. And I used to hear people mumble behind me, she doesn't look like a Miss India. I said, oh God, what does a Miss India look like? Because I've never dressed up. Today I'm dressed up. So I sent a photo to my children. So they sent a message back. Mom, you love posing. So it's not that. It's just that I feel so happy because my hair's growing. I've been bald for the whole of the year and without... Nobody tells you that when you have chemo, not only your hair falls out, your eyebrows fall out, eyelashes fall out, everything falls out. And you're fighting this enormous chemical warfare within yourself, for your family, to keep your spirit high. And I feel happy.
I do want to come back to that particular battle because that is a battle that now so many of us publicly can also resonate with, and we need more of you to tell us not only what will happen, but that you can deal with it with a sense of humor. But before that, coming back to your time as Miss India, and you tell her, I think you said something very interesting somewhere. We had Sharmila Tagore here last month,
yeah.
And you said that she tied your sari when you went for Miss India.
Before I reached Miss India, of course, after I told my parents that I wanted to be participating, my father thought, oh my goodness, this daughter of mine who walks like a tomboy and all that. So he put, mom and dad put one mirror, I mean both on either side, and put a book on my head and make me walk like a lady. And I think it helped. And after winning Miss Bengal, then we went to Bombay for Miss India, and then Sharmila Tagore tied my sari. I think 6 safety pins she put. And Parveen Babi put my lipstick, because I never wore lipstick. And then red lipstick. And then she put some sort of some kind of a paste. And she says, don't worry, you won't lick your lipstick off. So, and Devanand was one of the judges.
So with seminal figures like that as part of your unofficial team, how could you not win?
But, yeah, I suppose, yes.
What did winning feel like to you? What did you think would change for you once you became Miss India?
I dumped my boyfriend. Because he was a very mean person. And I can say that. If you are in a situation or a relationship which is not good for you, don't get stuck in it. Get out of it. It's within you. The power is within you, not somebody else.
Okay, that's a drastic change, but for him.
This is a secret I've never told anybody in the whole world.
But tell us, I think you went to, when you went to Miss International,
yes.
And that was in Tokyo.
That was in Tokyo.
What was that like? Because now you had girls from all over the world.
Yeah, and...
And no Sharmila Tagore.
Yeah, and so I arrived... And my mother designed my dress, and she had sequences stitched on my swimming costume. My mom's sitting there, by the way, right in the corner.
And welcome and thank you for being here.
And I'm very grateful to Algebra, because wherever they have a talk, I'll say I won't. I have to bring my mother. So they have been really kind. Algebra is a phenomenal setup, because it stimulates you, makes you think, and makes you meet old friends all over India. I really feel blessed in a way, because I lived in Chennai, and my husband commanded the military police South India. We stayed at Fort St. George, and we had so many friends here. And then you lose touch because you go so far away back to Delhi.
We're very glad to be able to bring you back, and thank you to your mother for being here, for being part of the Algebra journey. Thank you.
When I arrived, it was at night, and I was sharing a room with Miss Sri Lanka. In the morning, I got up and came out of the room, and there were these tall, very beautiful women from 62 countries. They were all coming out, and I thought to myself, oh my God, and I quickly went back, and my mother had designed 4-inch heels for me. You know, that was one of the criteria. What did they call those closed-in shoes, ma? High heels? No. Those shoes with the closed toe. What is it called? Some intelligent word. So I wore those and came on, and I thought, oh, this is good. But it's so expensive. Going to Japan, going to have your head and all, is not possible. So I thought, now what should I do? So I just put hair oil in my hair, put a bun. And I roamed around like that. And as I said, when I was selected in the first 15 is when I thought, oh my God, maybe I stand a chance. So I Miss Ireland, who became my friend, I asked her, can you please do some makeup for me? And she did my makeup. And then I was the second runner-up in the Miss International.
And I think it bears reminding ourselves that actually both the domains that you had by then succeeded in as a national swimming champion and then as Miss India, and I don't think there was anybody else who managed both ever, both now have entire armies of people working behind the scenes.
They're so lucky. They have so many phenomenal designer outfits and all. I had nothing.
But what was it like to be a professional athlete without formal help and representing the country?
As an athlete professionally, you don't need anyone, because you are what your performance personifies. But as a beauty queen, especially like me, who knows nothing about style, fashion or nakhra, you know, it was very difficult for me. So, I mean, I haven't changed till now.
We then became a film career, but the film career also has a very interesting trajectory. And it starts with a magazine cover.
Because of my swimming. When I was 16, I came out on the cover of the GS magazine. I don't know if any old timers here ever saw the GS magazine. Yeah? So sizzling water baby. Yeah. So Rishi Kapoor saw that. And I was 16 and he showed it to his dad, Raj Kapoor, who wrote to my father and said, we want to cast Nafisa in a movie. And my father said, no. So subsequently, Bobby Premier was in Calcutta. So they all came. And you know, for a swimming trained champion, whatever I want to call me, just ordinary girl, to have Rishi Kapoor ring you up and come over and then invite your parents and Raj Kapoor. I mean, like, they, you know, like, it's like they enveloped us in this royal crystal world of, I think it was like magic. For me, it was like magic and all that affection, all that doting. So we became great friends. And subsequently, at Raj Kapoor's birthday parties, when I met Shashi and his sons, that's how Junood happened, actually.
But that's 5 years later. That's
long time later.
So for 5 years, your father said no, and you said okay.
And I was swimming, I was training, I was winning, and I was in school, so I didn't bother. Then after I won Miss India, then things changed a little bit because then I did some ads. I did one famous ad called Taj tea or something. Remember that? And I thought to myself, oh wow, I think I look good on screen. I must do a 70mm movie now. So that's a. Then when Junoon happened, Kunal is Shashi's son, elder son, and he said that Shyam Benegal is looking for a girl. I said, no, I don't want to act. And he said, give me your photos. He was really sweet. They were great friends, Shashi, Jennifer. And he took my photos, showed it to Shyam, and Shyam said, I have to meet you. And I came to Bombay, and Junoon was mine.
How did you, what was your audition like?
Nowadays, it's so horrible, I can't tell you. Thousands of people come for audition. In our days, it was just you and you yourself. And the director knew what they wanted. And Shyam, of course, over breakfast, when he met me for the first time, he put his hands on his chin and he stared at me and I ate my heart out. Then I suddenly looked up and I saw him staring at me. I said, why are you doing that? I get a stomachache. He says, okay, come now, we'll go to my office. And he, you know, Jennifer had designed that white dress, the first outfit I wore in my movie. And he said, could you please wear this and just stand in front of the camera, turn left, turn right and smile. And of course, I was working with the best.
So I was just about to ask, because Junoon, of course, Shyam Benegal himself, but your fellow actors, there was Shashi, there was Jennifer,
Nasir, Tom Alter, Pearl Padamsi, Kulbhushan.
Kulbhushan Parvanda, that's
awesome,
right.
Awesome.
So did you arrive on set intimidated? Because these were all, they were actors, professional actors.
They, you know, the beauty of working in a Shashi Kapoor, Shyam Benegal production is that they're so culturally rich. And it's like being in a big family, you know. There's no superiority. It's all encompassing in the sense that we're always together. And since I was a kid in the block, I used to ask all the questions, and how do you do this? How should I act? How should I react? And they quietly,
so will
each
you
one
tell
used
us,
to tell me.
So will you tell us a little about who you asked for advice and what advice did they give you?
I asked, my main teacher was Nasir and Jennifer. And of course, there was one scene in the Junoon where I become hysterical and scream when that sepoy comes in and stabs.
My mother stabs the sepoy
who came looking for me. And I thought, I was supposed to become hysterical. I've never been hysterical in my life. So I said, so I asked Jennifer, I said, how will I do this so hard? Everyone's watching. And she just started screaming on top of her voice. And she said, that's it, just do that. I said, oh, okay. So when the shot was started, and she came and he stabbed her, that sepoy, and I started screaming. And Sean Benigam said, cut, cut, and all that, came, hugged me. Oh, welcome, what a great actress you are. So I'm like a sponge. I want to learn. I want to learn. I know nothing about nothing, I'm happy to learn from somebody else. I'm not ashamed. If I need to understand something, and of course today we have Google.
But tell us about your first shot ever on set. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
And did you immediately feel I belong here, or did you feel, what am I doing here?
No. When the first shot is outside that my beautiful old colonial bungalow in Lucknow, and I'm wearing my bonnet. Do you remember, anyone seen Junoon? And I'm just staring into Shashi Kapoor is staring at me from the hedge somewhere, and then I look angry. So that was the first shot. And when the shot started, I suddenly realized that everyone who was watching became just went into darkness. And it was all about my own reaction. I think that's what acting is. You just go into another alter ego and you become the person you're meant to be, not who you are for that moment.
Given that in your own life you have played any number of roles, is that what appealed to you about cinema? What was, other than the glamour and this, of course, the
not
magic?
Not the glamour. It's just the great respect I have for the profession. It's a very difficult profession, and you really have to hang around a long time between each take and all that. It's very hard work. And to be rewarded by appreciation, I think that is the best thing. And you know, Major Saab, with Amitabh, I learned, if I had not worked with Amitabh, I wouldn't have realized what a phenomena he is. Because after Junoon, I gave up acting because my father came and said, don't act, though I had signed another film with Nasir Hussain and Rishi and me. Dad said no, so I went back. 18 years later, Tinu Anand called because I had done an ad for him for Binaka toothpaste on the rocks of Bombay. I was leaving. I had just done that Johnson Baby, No More Tears. I launched it in India. And then I was leaving and I said, okay, I'm going now and all that. And Tinu said, please do this one ad for me and all that. I said, no. He said, Baba, just do it for me. I said, okay. I sat on my rock and the wave hit me and then I smiled and I did all that. And then I said, okay, bye. And I ran out of... And he got so confused, he dropped the film in the sea. So, but they didn't get spoiled. So that's how Tinu knew me. So he rang me up after 18 years and he said, listen, I'm making this movie, Major Saab. Said, if you're making me Angrez, I'm not doing it. He said, no, you're playing a major doctor, army. I said, fantastic. So that's how Major Saab happened. And if you remember, Amitabh had been sick after Coolie for 6 years. He had not acted, and then he acted in a movie. Do you remember the name of the movie? He acted in, it just got released while we were making Major Saab, and it bombed at the box office, literally bombed. And The media is so cruel and mean. And they love to take off at everybody, and they took off at Amitabh. Like, it was, I found it very sad. And this Amitabh was like torn in shreds, and I used to try to keep his morale up. And because he used to tell me, he says, they don't make many women like you, because I don't care if you're Amitabh, I care because you're my co-star, and if you're upset, I want to make you happy, basically. And then I watched him act. He's a powerhouse. Powerhouse.
So I want to go back to Junoon for a different reason, because you did, of course, right after that, get approached by Nasir Hussain for a 3-film contract.
Yeah.
But you also, out of that film, acquired a husband, right?
Yeah, because tell us, Junoon was shot in Jaipur in my husband's regiment. And that's how I got
to. So tell us how you met your husband, and what about him did it for you?
He was the only bachelor man in uniform. He was much older. And I'm used to having a father figure, because my dad is my hero. He passed away 2 years ago at 93. But my husband is a great army man. And totally opposite of me, who, he's a very calm, cool, and collected, hardly speaks. And I'm bilkul opposite of that. And, opposites attract. That's what they say.
But if
you... And I loved his horses.
Was it the shared love of horses?
I think it was, all my courtship was riding. And... then I tease him sometimes. I said, see, I couldn't leave your horses, so I had to marry you. But I've had a wonderful army life, a life of so much strength and safety and brotherhood and a great solid upbringing for my children, And with very little, we had so much.
I just want to, before that, come to something interesting, because you did mention again the Nasir, he asked to sign you for a 3-film contract, and you did.
I haven't spoken about my cancer.
We will not get off before we've done that.
No ringing the bell. I'm here.
But actually, this question does lead to that, because at every stage of your life, you've shown such remarkable conviction in yourself. So Nasir Hussain wanted you to sign a 3-film contract, and you said, no, I'll only sign it for one. And similarly, you decided you wanted to be in Miss India, and you went. You decided you wanted to act, and you went. What about your father asking you not to act then did something? It seems so out of character to the fighter that you have been at every stage.
I think we are brought up to respect our parents, and I truly dote on my parents, and I didn't want to hurt them in any way. So I think that was the reason.
But now
I want to talk about cancer.
Yes, because, so that's where we are absolutely
because
coming.
Cancer has become such a common phenomena today.
Will you tell us just a little about what you felt when you were diagnosed?
Well, before I was diagnosed, I went to the doctor and I said, I've got this pain here. Then after some time, it went here. It went all over the place. And I went to the doctor. They did ultrasound. They said, everything is fine. 2 months later, same thing with more pain. And I said, no, there is something wrong with me. And then they said, okay, go do one more ultrasound. And then they diagnosed this. There was fluid in my abdomen because it had metastasized and become stage 3 from God knows what stage it was when I went to them. And then after that, I had to have, for me, Leela, the owner of Leela, Madhu and Dinesh Nair, the family, have been a great source of strength. I want to remember them because I was sitting in their hotel also. Is that when I was diagnosed and I was, you're so confused. First, as a person, as a patient, you're confused because you just don't know where to go, what to do. And that's where families come in. They have to be your support. They have to do all the fact finding. They have to find the right doctors. You have to go and find out who, which doctor is going to cut you open, and I'm cut from right up here to down, you know, like a huge, this big scar, and that whole process. So the Nair, Madhu Nair and Dinesh Nair, they just took over my life also as friends, and they took me in Bombay to all the doctors, they organized everything, they kept us whole family in the hotel. So, you know, it's that's the value. But insurance is, I hope everybody here has health insurance. Do you? All of you? Yes? No, there are not too many yeses I'm hearing. The insurance is, because it's so expensive to fall sick. I didn't know that. Each chemo was like 2 lakhs 20, something insane amount. And I used to watch, and I used to think, what about the other people? What about who don't have insurance? Who are poor? What do they do? You know, it's not only depressing, it's heartbreaking. I used to be heartbroken watching the suffering of other people. And wherever I went for my chemo, when I met people, I used to go and hold their hand, and I said, you know, believe you can overcome this. Because if you just go into a hospital where there is chemo going on, you see the fear in the eyes of patients, and that you must take that fear away. You must give the belief that they can overcome. And before that also, you know, we have so many natural remedies that are good for us. Haldi, pepper and haldi together, garlic, onions, these sort of things. Increase these sort of things in your life. The government of India should empower the common man with good nutrition, because it's when your immunity is down because of maybe lack of nutrition also that you pick up, or you've had some serious illness. Like I had swine flu, then after I got pneumonia, then maybe my immunity was down, which is why my cancer started. You know, it could be anything. Because cancer is there in everybody's...
Will you tell us what? Because you're right, there are two dimensions. One is physically managing the disease, right? The just the brutal toll it takes on your body. But the other is, what do you attribute your healing, if you can attribute it more to one or the other? What is the role you would say is this, the familial support, the emotional infrastructure, and just, to what is the physical infrastructure?
I just put blinkers on in my life, and I just said, this cancer is not there, and I'm going to overcome it, and I'm going to fight it, and I'm not going to think about it. So every time, you know, you ask your doctor, what is the prognosis? Oh, 8 to 12 months. So I'm in my 12th month now. And I said, who's the doctor to tell me all this? You know, I should know for myself what I want to do. You have to have that inner fighting spirit. And of course, miracles. Always pray for miracles. It's my life. My life is of miracles, of prayer, of positive energy, of cosmic, how would I say it? Unifying great people who didn't even know me all around the world sent in wishes and prayers. It gives you a huge sense of inner strength and security. Family, of course, were amazing. Friends were phenomenal. I mean, like my best friend, Gabby, for every surgery, every chemo, she came and sat by my side. You know? So we used to laugh and joke, and I never felt sad, I never cried, and never thought, I'm going to die now. I used to think about other people. I want them to get well. And people always call me, ask me questions, ask for my help. Whoever it is, I always reach out and help. Whether I'm on a plane, I'm on a train, or I'm going anywhere, people come and ask me, how can I've got this, I've got that, how can I deal with it? You know, that is the reason why I spoke out that I had cancer. Because the moment I knew I had cancer, there is, you know, we have cancer marker tests now in India, or, you know, it tells you what kind, like CA125 is for ovarian cancer. Then you have for breast cancer. You have different cancer markers for prostate cancers, abdomen cancer, colon cancer. Now, these markers are available. So if the doctors, it's just about 1,200 rupees. If you have a suspect, or the doctor says, I think you should do the test. If they had done this test for me, when I first went with strange pains, because finally when they did my CA125, I was 6,500 and normal is below 30. You know? So they would have picked it up like that. The other thing is, I was just reading in the papers, there was this lady who was abroad with her children in a games park, and there was thermal imaging, and you know, people were walking through it, and you could see. Thermal imaging, imaging is not expensive, but they were having fun looking at their bodies and hot spots and all, and she suddenly saw one side of her breast, there was a hot spot. So she took a photo with her camera, with her phone, and she went back after holiday and showed it to her doctor and said that I was playing in the game theme park, and in the thermal imaging, this showed up, what is it? And she had breast cancer. You know, so I think it's important that the government finds cheap solutions to finding out if people's health is at risk, so that we can help them and nip it in the bud. The important thing in cancer is you've got to nip it in the bud, and then you're sure to be out of it.
And as a last question, still on the cancer, but something you alluded to earlier, because one of the debilitating aspects, it's quite literally physically debilitating. You said you lost your hair with chemo, you lost your eyelashes.
Is also okay.
I just want to ask,
Your core is just shattered.
Yeah.
The core. You just don't have it in you to say, am I going to overcome this? And then you have to push yourself.
And I think that was my question. How did you, because particularly for somebody whose public life has also been about the business of looking good, it is, even for people who have not been in the business of looking good, one of the hardest things to deal with are the physical changes. How did you focus? How did you internalize on what really mattered rather than the external losses?
See, externally, I've never really bothered about what I am. So, which is why when all my hair, of course, I made my grandchildren shave off my hair. When on the 12th day of the first chemo, the hair started falling. So I told my daughter, bring your children and tell them to shave off my hair, because that's very traumatic for little children. Suddenly nani with hair down to her waist, suddenly has clumps falling out, you know. So we had a big fun tamasha, and they shaved off all my hair and all that. Next day, my little granddaughter, who was 5 at the time, she goes, Nani, I don't like this hairstyle of yours. I said, you don't blame me now. You shaved off my hair. So basically, that shock, I think they sort of felt that, you know, maybe we cut all poor Nani's hair off. But the thing is, I don't look in the mirror, technically, because even when I had long hair, I used to just do it and put a clip. So when all my hair fell off, I didn't have any reason to look in the mirror. But after, I used to, once in a while, look and I said, I look very weird. Wonder what's wrong with me and all. It's only when after my 6th chemo surgery, everything was over, that I looked in the mirror and I found my eyebrows and eyelashes growing. Then I realized I had no eyelashes, no eyebrows. I thought, oh, nobody ever mentions these sort of things for chemo. You know? So you're struggling to live. So it's not about the vanity. It's about strength within your core. And keeping the morale of your family high is so important. Because you need them, but they need you as much. And I pray and pray and pray that people who are diagnosed are able to overcome. Because it's you can. Let's not say it's tough. Let's say you can overcome. And I think the worst thing people do to you when you are in cancer, they'll come and tell you about some other family who had cancer and how they died. I used to think to myself, I said, oh my God, how am I going to get over this? And then I used to look on the funny side. I said, you know, doctors, can you imagine my onco neurosurgeon, onco breast surgeon? Yeah, oh my, hi. No, once I was in Manali, can you imagine, in a tea shop talking to somebody, and these two people came to me and they said, we heard your voice. Are you Nafisa? I said, yes. Oh, we are Dr. So-and-so, Dr. So-and-so. And they said, ma'am, how are you feeling? I said, I'm feeling good now. Oh, but you know, my mother had cancer and she died. And I thought, so doctors also, I joke, I keep telling people, never tell them about the positive stories, because honest to God, what has given me the most amount of comfort and strength are the people who I met who were in their fourth stage of cancer and were told they had 4 months to live and now in their 10th year of living and cancer free. They are the ones that gave me strength.
Nafisa, no, thank you.
Are you going to ring the bell?
Yes, she is so terrified she won't ring the bell, but she has made eyes at me. But thank you. And I think there is not just a lesson, many lessons, but the art of living fiercely with a light touch. Thank you very much.
Thank
for,
you.
For your courage, for your grace, and for sharing that story with such candor. Thank you very much, Nafisa. Thank you.